students to the lecture endodontic mishaps, which is also called as procedural accidents happening during root canal treatment. Learning outcomes for this lecture, endodontic mishaps, are list mishaps occurring during access cavity preparation, working length determination, cleaning and shaping, obturation and post-vase preparation. Describe the causes, prevention, treatment of these endodontic mishaps. Endodontic mishaps or procedural accidents can happen during any stage of the root canal treatment, even though you take utmost care while doing the procedure. These mishaps can happen during preparing an access, or during cleaning and shaping, or during irrigation procedures, or when obturation is being done, or any other miscellaneous causes like during post-vase preparation. So what are the causes of access-related endodontic mishaps? It can be treating the wrong tooth, missing canals while locating the canals, damage to the existing restoration, failure to remove caries and unsupported enamel, and crown fractures. Endodontic mishap during access cavity preparation can be due to treating a wrong tooth. The main reason for treating a wrong tooth is due to misdiagnosis or diagnosing the wrong tooth. In such cases, when you diagnose the wrong tooth and started doing a root canal treatment, you have to inform the patient that you have started a root canal on a wrong tooth. Make a note in the case paper that such thing has happened. Make the patient explain and treat both the tooth appropriately. The other reason for treating a wrong tooth is may occur during single tooth isolation with rubber dam. A wrong tooth can be isolated, leading to access on the wrong tooth. To avoid such mishaps, mark the tooth with a marker before applying the rubber dam. One more reason for endodontic mishap during access preparation is to failure to remove caries as well as weak and unsupported tooth structure. Failure to remove all the caries during the access cavity preparation can lead to contamination and reinfection of the prepared root canal with saliva and bacteria, leading to eventual endodontic failure. If you don't remove caries and unsupported tooth structure during access cavity preparation, it can also lead to breakage of the crown or the tooth in between the appointments, leading to contamination and eventual endodontic. Missed canals. Sometimes you might miss some canals which are not easily accessible or readily apparent from the pulp chamber. So main reason for missing the canals is lack of knowledge about the root canal anatomy. Remember, each tooth can have different root canals. Examples can be mandibular central incisor. Usually we think there is only one canal, but it might have two canals, that is buccal and lingual. One more example is maxillary second premolar, usually having two canals. We may think it's only one canal, but it might be having buccal and lingual canal. Maxillary first molar having four canals, that is second mesiobuccal canal. So these are the examples. You should have thorough knowledge that these alternate anatomies can be present. So you need to search, carefully examine the radiographs for root outlines and root canals. Use slop technique, cone shift technique to see if there are any extra roots are there. So if you do not try to find out extra canals, there are chances that you might miss these canals and can lead to eventual endodontic failure. Prevention is by taking radiograph, as I said, use of a slop technique, two radiographs, okay. Using magnification, either it can be a loop or a microscope, use of ultrasonic tips to remove the ledges and shells in the pulp chamber and to locate these canals, use of dyes like methylene dye, which stains the organic pulp tissue and you can locate the canal, use of sodium hypochlorite. When you use sodium hypochlorite to flood the pulp chamber, if there is any missed canals, the organic tissue present inside the canals will create small bubbles. When you see these bubbles coming out from the canals, you can say that there's one more canal is there. And the most important thing when you're doing access cavity is your access cavity should be adequate enough to show the entire floor of the pulp chamber so that you don't miss any canal. One more reason for endodontic mishap during access cavity preparation is a damage to the existing restoration. So whenever there is a existing porcelain restoration is there and there is a need for root canal treatment, it is always better to remove the porcelain crown and then go ahead with the access cavity preparation. Placing a rubber dam clamp directly on the margins of porcelain crown can damage the crown margin and can lead to fracture of the porcelain. The patient may again complain that you have started the root canal and then it has fractured. You may have to replace. He may ask to replace. So you better tell the patient that there's already a porcelain crown is there. And I may have to do root canal through the porcelain crown. In that case, it is always better to remove the porcelain crown and do the root canal and do a new one rather than doing through the crown. Only in circumstances which you cannot avoid, then you may have to do through the crown. One more disadvantage of doing the root access cavity preparation through the crown is that you may not be able to see the pulp chamber very clearly. And you will not come to know the axial inclination of the crown in relation to the root. So that's a disadvantage for you. So it's always better to remove the crown and do a access preparation for root canal treatment. Crown fracture. Here we are saying crown fracture means it is fracture of the crown of the tooth. The tooth has got two parts, root as well as crown. We are talking about the crown fracture of the tooth. The main reasons for crown fracture during access cavity preparation can be a pre-existing infarction or a crack which is present. To avoid crown fractures during root canal treatment, always do a occlusal reduction before you attempt access cavity or working length, or before the working length is established. If more than two-thirds of the crown is fractured and usually the prognosis is poor, do not attempt to do root canal treatment. Better is to go for extraction. The second type of mishaps which can occur during root canal treatment are instrument related. These mishaps can be categorized as ledge formation, cervical canal perforations, mid-root perforations, apical perforations, separated instruments and foreign objects, and canal blockage. Ledge formation. Ledge is an internal transportation of the canal which prevents the positioning of an instrument to the apex, in otherwise patent canal. So if you pay attention to the definition, it says that the canal was patent when you started the root canal treatment. During the later stages of the root canal treatment, you are not able to place the tip of the instrument up to the working length. The main causes of ledge formation are access cavities that fail to provide straight line access from the orifice to the apex, use of straight or too large instruments in curved canals, curved roots. Curved roots means curvature of the root is more than 30 degrees are usually considered curved roots. Packing of debris in the apical portion of the canal, and rapid advancement in file sizes are skipping the file size, and avoiding recapitulation of the instruments when you are doing cleaning and shaping can also lead to ledge formation. How do you recognize a red ledge has happened? When you place an instrument, the instrument is not able to reach the full working length where the canal was patent before. Now you are trying to place the file. Now it is not able to reach the full working length. You feel that there is a sensation of tip of instrument hitting against a solid wall. There is loose feeling of instrument instead of binding in the apical part of the canal. When you take a radiograph, it is evident that the instrument which is in place is not reaching the canal. It is short of working length. So how do you correct whenever there is a ledge formation is there? So you take a very small size, file size maybe 10 or 15 size, and give a very gentle distinct curve at the tip. The teardrop shape of the silicone stopper should be facing, the tip of the teardrop shape stopper should be in the same direction in which you are given a curve. Using gentle watch winding motion, advance the instrument until you feel the resistance. Whenever you feel the resistance, slightly retract the instrument, rotate it, maybe clockwise or anti-clockwise. Again, use that watch winding motion and try to pass beyond the ridge. Again, you find the resistance, slightly withdraw. Again, rotate maybe 20 degrees or 25 degrees, again clockwise, and again try to pass. This step you will be doing until you gently pass beyond the ledge. So once your tip of the file is apical to the ledge, use very short back and forth motions so that you can slowly file off that ledge. Okay, this is how we repair a ledge formation. So what are the prevention you can do to avoid a ledge formation? Use of stainless steel patency files to determine the canal curvature. Accurate evaluation of the radiograph and tooth anatomy to see if there are any curvatures there. If there is any curvature, it's always better to use flexible files like night eye files. Use of safe-ended instruments with non-cutting tips. Pre-curving can be done for curved canals. Use of flexible files, as I said, night eye files. Sequential filing with recapitulation, and do not skip instrument sizes. Do not use stiffer large size instruments in curved part of the canal. When we say about stiffer large size instruments, we are talking about file sizes greater than 25. Okay, these files are not very flexible, very difficult to bend. So in these circumstances, it is very difficult to pre-curve the files and follow the curvature. So in those situations, it is always better to use flexible night eye files. Always use a copious irrigation to prevent packing of the debris. So if you follow these precautions, definitely there will be no ledge formation. The second mishaps during instrumentation is perforations. According to AAE, which stands for American Association of Endodontists, a perforation is defined as a mechanical or pathological communication between the root canal system and external tooth surface. Perforations can happen during access cavity preparation, where you can identify there is a leakage of saliva into the access cavity or sodium hypochlorite into the mouth. Perforations can also happen at the radicular area, which can be classified as cervical, mid-root, or apical root perforation. Cervical canal perforations usually occur by locating the canal orifices or flaring the coronal one-third, usually with the Gates Glidden or coronal orifice flaring instruments. You can suddenly see a blood coming from the canal. If this blood is fresh blood, then you may suspect that there might be a perforation. Mid-root perforations are usually common in curved canals. When there is a ledge formed, you want to gain the working lengths, and you are using a large stiff instrument, stainless steel file, and trying to rotate clockwise and slowly trying to gain length, there are chances that you can perforate and go into the periapical area. So whenever there is a ledge formation happens and you are facing some resistance, withdraw the file, take a radiograph, and see if the file is following the curvature or not. If it is not following the curvature, as I said, you may have to give a small gentle curve and use that watch winding motion to slowly go beyond the ledge. Okay, if the canal straightens out, there might may lead to strip perforation. In both cases, whenever there is a perforation, you may see a sudden appearance of blood coming from the apical root. Perforation usually occurs when the instrument goes into the periapical area beyond the confines of the root canal. That means you are not able to stick to your working length, and then there is or else it might be overestimation of the working length, that the file can go beyond the confines of the canal and leading to apical root perforation. Again, whenever there is an apical root perforation, you may see blood gushing into the canal. So the main reasons of apical root perforation is file not negotiating into the curved canal, not establishing an accurate working length, instrumenting beyond the canal apical confines, overuse of chelating agents along with straight, stiffer, large size instruments to negotiate ledging, canal blockage, or zipping. So recognition of perforation: place an instrument into the opening and take a radiograph. It becomes evident that it may not be following the canal path, but the file going into the periradicular areas. Rinsing and blotting with paper points and use of magnification with the help of loops or endoscope or a microscope can clearly visualize the site and extent of perforation. There is sudden appearance of bleeding. Patient may complain of pain when the instrument touches the periodontal ligament. So how do we rectify or correct this? If it is very small, you can seal it from inside. If it is large, then you have to seal it from inside and later surgically expose the site and seal again. Usually the prognosis of large perforations are poorer. The material of choice for sealing these perforations, if aesthetics is concerned, the repair material can be calcium sulfate barrier along with composite, glass enamel cement and white MDA. White MDA is the most popular, and studies have shown that the repair of perforation is more better with MDA compared with other materials. In posterior tooth, you can use super EPA, amalgam and MDA. Amalgam is nowadays not used, so still the material of choice is MDA. Other than MDA, you have a biodentin these days. It has got similar results as MDA. Prevention of perforation. Evaluation of anatomy of tooth before the endodontic therapy is very important. Always use smaller flexible files for curved canals. A recapitulation with smaller files and copious irrigation. Confirming the working length and maintaining the instrument within the confines of the working length. Prevent overuse of chelating agent. Chelating agents means use of EDTA, ethylene diamino tetraacetic acid. Don't overuse it because it can lead to softening of the dentin causing perforation. In most cases, you may not require EDTA. You can use only sodium hypochlorite alone. Mesiobuccal canal is in the most danger to be stripped because of its canal curvature. Use anti-curvature filing whenever there is curvature. That means anti-curvature filing means pressure should be maintained on the mesial wall of mesiodistally curved canal by the instrument to avoid delicate danger zone of distal wall. Use of careful use of rotary instruments inside the canal should be performed to avoid perforation. Instrument separation. This instrument separation means breakage of instruments. Most of the time, the reason for instrument separation or breakage is due to improper or overuse of instruments. The causes for instrument separation is variation from root canal anatomy. That means tooth is tilted or canals having a very greater curvature. The second reason can be overuse or damaged or dull instruments. Inadequate irrigation. Use of excessive pressure while inserting into the canal, inadequate access cavity preparation, instrument binding into the canal and efforts to remove it, and skipping file sizes, rotating an instrument more than one quarter can also lead to instrument separations. The various methods of managing instrument separation, there are different instrument retrieval kits are available. There are like Masaran kit, Ruddle and Egler post remover, spinal tap, needle instrument retrieval system. You can also use ultrasonic instruments to loosen and flush out the broken instruments. Masaran kit is usually used to retrieve an instrument which is broken at the coronal third or the initial parts of the middle third. It is not much of use when if the instrument is broken at the later parts of the middle third or apical third or even in the curved parts of the canal. It usually have parts called as a trepan burs and extractor. So the first step in using a Masaran kit is obtaining a straight line access to the top part of the root canal using a round burr. After you gain straight line access to the top part of the root canal, then you use the end cutting trepan burrs in anti-clockwise direction so as to free the 4 millimeters of the fragment. The cutting part of the trepan burrs, what does it do is that it removes the dentin around the coronal part of the broken instrument. Then you take an extractor, open it over the free end of the fragment, firmly hold the extractor in place and rotate the screw head until the fragment is tightly gripped. The extractor should be moved in an anti-clockwise direction if you are attempting to remove cutting instruments, and the extractor is moved in a clockwise direction for removing the filling instruments. This is the instrument retrieval system. It is different from Masaran kit. It has a microtube instead of an trepan burrs and a screw wedge instead of an extractor. See, the microtube is usually used to cut the dentin around the coronal part of the instrument, whereas the screw wedge is used to hold the instrument or grip the instrument and remove it from the canal. Microtube tip
is rotated around the coronal part of the fractured instrument so as to remove the dentin around that one. So let's look at the steps of instrument retrieval system. Similar to the Masaran kit, use a small round burr to gain access, straight line access to the coronal end of the broken instrument. Select a microtube, insert into the canal, then start rotating the microtube in anti-clockwise direction so that you free the coronal part of the fractured instrument. Place a wedge, turn the wedge in a clockwise direction to engage the instrument, and finally move the microtube out of the canal to retrieve the separated instrument. Then this is one more technique to manage a broken instrument. Here we are not removing the instrument, but we are bypassing the broken instrument in an attempt to clean the canal which is apical to the separated instrument. So it is an attempt to bypass it with a small file or a reamer. Bypassing is made easier with a lubricant. If successful, the canal preparation can be completed and the canal filled. Thus, the instrument segment which is separated becomes a part of the filling material. If the fragment extends past the apex and efforts to remove it non-surgically are unsuccessful, then the corrective treatment usually is an apical surgery. Canal blockage. An obstruction in previously patent canal system that prevents access to the apical constriction or apical stop is called as a canal blockage. The causes of canal blockage can be due to packed dentinal chips, tissue debris, cotton pellets, or fractured instruments. A fibrous blockage can also occur when a vital tissue is compacted and solidified against the apical constriction. Ledge formation in curved canals can also lead to canal blockage. So recognition. Usually when confirmed with working length, you are not the file is not able to reach the desired working length, is sign that there is correction of canal blockage. Recapitulation with chelating agents and small file in quarter turn technique can be used. One should avoid giving excessive rotation to the instrument as it may cause instrument separation. If this doesn't solve the problem, then you can use undersonics, that means ultrasonics, to dislodge the dentin chips by action of acoustic streaming. If the blockout occurs at a curve, then you precurve the instruments and gently recapitulate. Copious irrigation is advised to remove the canal blockage. That's all for today. The next part, obturation related and other miscellaneous, will be covered in part 2 of endodontic mishaps.